you believe that God has a word for you tonight? Now, here's the thing about the Word of God, and here's how we have to come. My spiritual dad and mentor for years has maintained this, and he teaches this to this day. Anytime Pastor Mackey comes, you'll hear him say this. And it is so, so true. In order to really change your heart, first and foremost, you have to change your mind. The difficulty about that is this, is that oftentimes we can think or believe we are so right. Come on now. We have philosophy, we have ideology, we have theology. We have all these things that have worked together, and we have this understanding that that's what makes us distinct from anyone else. We've got to stop for a moment before we ever enter the Word tonight, and we have to understand this one principle that's so important, and it's the one thing that differentiates the kingdom of God from American thinking. When we become in the kingdom of God, distinction is no longer important. Distinction is an American thing. It's something that we think, I need to be distinct, I want to be distinct, I want to be different from everybody else, but it's not a kingdom thing. Because you understand something, in God's kingdom, the only one that is distinct is Him. And if you understand the Word of God, we are made in His image and likeness. And when we come into His kingdom in heaven, we're not going to be distinct at all, because the Word of God says that we're all going to look like Him. And yet with our mind, listen to me, with our mind, we're trying to be something that is anti-kingdom. Boy, I thought we were going so good there for just a moment. It's like we come to a screeching halt right there. So let me talk to you about some important things as we get into this tonight, and I hope you'll bear with me in this. I think discipleship is the great calling of the church. Nowhere will you find there, even from the Great Commission on, will you find anything that's about just saving souls. The calling has always been, from the very beginning, about making disciples. Jesus made disciples, and then He called His disciples to make disciples. When we understand that, there's a lot of things that also come into our American philosophy and idealism is this. Is that we think that we can moderate, balance, differentiate, and make good reason of all truth. But I'm going to tell you something tonight, we can't. Everybody hear what I just said? We can't do that. And so what's important in what we're going to talk about tonight is relationship. Now, in order for us to have a relationship, even with me standing up here tonight, for us to have a relationship, there has to be some sense of trust. Amen. Somebody say amen. Amen. Like, okay, this guy, he talks like a man of God. He behaves like a man of God. He knows the Word of God. He prays. And so there's a sense of trust that comes into that. And I'm going to tell you something. This is where we get messed up, because the Apostle Paul said this when he talked about that. You can have many, but you're not going to have many fathers. And he says this to the Corinthians. He says, know those who labor among you. And where we get messed up as Americans is we think we can hear all these voices and we're smart enough to differentiate. And what happens is we just get more confused. It would be like saying, I'm going to be an auto mechanic. And then trying to learn every make and model of car and how to fix all models of car at one time, and you understand something, you're going to be confused because they're all made differently. Foreign-made cars are different than domestic cars, and they all are different makes and models, and they all come with different things. And so that's kind of how we've gone through things. And oftentimes we find ourselves to be very confused. Now, I want to talk to you tonight because I think this is all important. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about us at Life Community Church, but more importantly, what not only our vision is, but what I believe God wants to do in all of us. If you have your Bible, turn with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse number 10. We're actually going to back up a little further from verse number 10. I'm getting there. I love reading out of my word. How about that? Leave the iPad at home. That's why I love Wednesday nights. Okay, so let's understand something here and why this is important. We're going to back up a little bit. We're going back to verse number 4. How many of you grew up in church? Can I see your hands? There's a few of us here tonight. The great problem with the church over the ages is this, is that oftentimes we lose the why. And let me explain that. We have traditions that are carried from one generation to the next. And the tradition is carried on, but the why of why that tradition was important is no longer passed on. And so it just becomes something that we do because nobody ever explained the why and why it's important, like we talked about on Sunday. There are a lot of ecumenical churches that do a lot of wonderful symbolic things that represent being fearful and reverent of God, but they're nothing more than symbolism or tradition because nobody explains the why in them. And the Apostle Paul, he's going to talk to the Thessalonians, and when he talks to them, when he went to Thessalonica that first time, he had great trouble there. You can go back to the book of Acts and you can read about the trouble that he had there. But he explains his methodology, why he does the things he does, and it's important for these people to understand why he does the things he does. He doesn't say, I'm just coming to you. He's establishing something that's important in every relationship. He's establishing trust. So I want you to read with you in chapter 2, verse number 4. It says, for we speak as messengers approved by God to be entrusted with the good news. Our purpose is to please God, not people. Let's stop there for a moment. Let's ask ourselves, what does that look like? What does it look like to please God and not people? So let's stop there because I think this is an important question. If God called Life Community Church for 23 years to be a church of 200 people, would that be okay? Absolutely, it would be okay. In fact, today I would be more than okay with that. You say, why is that? Because as long as you could do something that is, well, there we go, going out again. Am I there? As long as we could do something that would be continually sending out people, that'd be a great thing. Training up and sending out people, that'd be a wonderful thing. I'm not talking about keeping the same 200 people and being some kind of dysfunctional little clan, okay? I don't believe in that. But when I was a young pastor starting this church 23 years ago, my spiritual dad asked me an important question. He said, I want you to think about what kind of church you want this to be. More importantly, I want you to think about what kind of pastor you want to be. And when you begin to define those things, this is what I want you to think about. How can you effectively pastor a church of 100, 200, 300, 400, 500, 600, 700, 800? What are you going to do when you get to 1,000? Wow. At that time, I couldn't even think beyond that. But I understood what he was saying, and I realized that the why question is always important. Why are we doing what we're doing? And secondly is this, are we being effective at it? So I'm going to tell you what we do here and why it's important, and it's found in this passage here. It says, he alone examines the motives of our hearts. Never once did we try to win you with flattery, as you well know, and God is our witness that we were not pretending to be your friends just to get your money. We're going in and out again for some reason. As for human praise, we have never sought it from you or anyone else. Hand me that one, I guess, again. There we go. All right. As for human praise, we have never sought it from you or anyone else.
As apostles of Christ, we certainly had a right to make some demands of you, but instead, there is a translation issue right here. It says, like children among you, is what New Living says. But really that word, we can't translate it correctly because it's we acted gently among you. Or we were like a mother feeding and caring for her own children. Need to get this picture of what he's talking about here. There is a relationship that's established. We loved you so much that we shared with you not only God's good news, but our lives too. Don't you remember, dear brothers and sisters, how hard we worked among you? Night and day we toiled to earn a living so that we would not be a burden to any of you as we preached God's good news to you. You yourselves are our witnesses, and so is God, that we were devout and honest and faultless toward all of you believers. And you know that we treated each of you as a father treats his own children. We pleaded with you, encouraged you, and urged you to live lives in a way that God would consider worthy. That's important. To live lives in a way that God would consider worthy. Now, let's stop here because he's making an important mind change that should happen. It's not how we perceive it to be worthy. Amen. Did everybody understand? We're not the definer in this. You're not the one that gets definition to say, I'm living a life worthy of God. The only one who defines that is him. Amen. That what God would consider worthy, for he called you to share in his kingdom and glory. And so there's three things he says here that as a father he did with them. He pleaded, he encouraged, and he urged. God blessed Shelley and myself with three kids, and we had 9 years of marriage prior to having our kids and had been told by doctors, my wife had been told by doctors that we wouldn't have kids. And so by the time that we had our first child, Nathan, we pretty much had a plan about how we were going to parent. Not because some people say, I'm not going to parent that way because they get around other people's kids. That's not what we did. We both came from great homes and great parents, and we learned a lot from our parents. But we realized that even as our children were young, this is what we decided to do, that we weren't raising children, we were raising adults. Because if you begin to look at your children as children and you're raising children, you're going to get snookered by them. Because they come out of the womb deceptive. It's in the sin nature. Listen, we fell into the trap hook, line, and sinker. Our oldest, Nathan, I mean, he was as strong-willed as they came. And he didn't want to sleep alone. He doesn't want to be alone. He didn't want, and we made a lot of big, 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 big mistakes. And we realized in the middle of it that our sweet little boy, as sweet as he was a master manipulator. And if we didn't do something about it, he was going to win the game. And I'm not talking about the oldest. I'm talking about all three of them. Abigail's here tonight, and she was, in different ways, much the same way. And we begin to discover that there was a process that if we were going to make these and understand that we wanted our children to be great adults and not just great children, that there was a process that happened in this that didn't have anything to do with how we felt most of the time. Right. Give you an example. Last night, Shelley was going through Jonathan's backpack. Jonathan's our youngest. He's 11 and he's in the fifth grade. And he came home with a paper that wasn't great, which is real unusual for him. Because he's very smart. And He can go through material very quickly and learn it very quickly and does very well.
On this paper, he didn't, but there was something written by the teacher on there. I didn't know that.
So I'm about ready to go to bed. He's going to bed. He's upstairs talking to his mom, and he comes down and he tells me, "Dad, I made a bad grade on this paper. And here's the reason why. This kid in my class was telling a joke." And I was sitting there listening to the joke, and I didn't hear what the teacher was saying. I said, "Well, did you get in trouble?" "No, I didn't get in trouble." I said, "Okay, well, go to bed." You say, "You didn't make a big deal of it?" "No, because you understand something. One thing Shelley and I are still trying to learn is you pick your battles." So he goes to bed. I'm trying to go to sleep, and Shelley comes in there with the paper. And on the pop of the paper, there's writing from the teacher. And this is what it said. "Jonathan was talking. And I had to tell him to be quiet. He should have made 100 on this paper like he always does, but he was too busy visiting." Okay. So now we have a new problem. Because my son is being deceptive. And can I tell you something? Number one, you will never mature or progress in the kingdom of God being a deceiver. Number two, you will never make great relationships because people won't trust you. So I didn't go wake him up. I went to sleep, woke up this morning. He came in all happy, what like he always does every morning. Came in to jump on the bed and love me. I said, "Hold on a minute." I said, "We've got an issue." It was early. He said, "What?" I said, "You didn't tell me the truth last night." And here's what we're going to do about it. You're going to go into your teacher and you're going to tell her that you can't sit where you're sitting because you can't control yourself. And you're going to ask to be moved up next to her desk. And when that doesn't work and we're still having problems, we're going to handle this the way you know we handle it, which involves pain, number one. And number two, involves you not doing the things that you like to do. Because the one thing that you need to understand that's important about parenting is that you're no good if you don't keep your word. If you're always going back and saying, "Oh, well, never mind. I think you can do better, or you can do good." You think you're believing in your kids, but you're not making your kids believe in you. And so this is what he knows. He knows that what I just told him, you can take to the bank. That I'm going to ask him, because he went on a field trip today, I'm going to ask him tomorrow when he gets out of school, "Did you talk to your teacher? Did you tell her to move you?" And he's going to give me some lame excuse. And I'm going to email his teacher. Because you understand something. You say, "Pastor, why are you going to all that trouble for this one little deal?" I'm not raising a child, I'm raising an adult. So now let's come back to what we do as pastors. And the goal of a father is to raise great adults. And the goal of a Christian pastor and a father is to raise up mature believers. Now, I want everybody to hear what I'm about to say, because Paul just talked about this in Thessalonians. And you should hear what I'm about to say. You don't set that standard. You don't say, "Well, I've come to church all my life, or I was involved in this, or I was a pastor's kid, and that makes me mature." That does not make you mature. Because you don't set the standard. See, there are a lot of people that say, "Well, I've gone to church all my life, or I've served in this. I did a ministry one time. Therefore, Can I tell you, there are people, men I know that have pastored churches that are as immature, I mean, as a newborn babe walking down the aisle and giving their heart and life to Jesus. Do you know why they're immature? Stay with me. Because they have never submitted and taken correction. Because in order to mature, you have to submit and take correction. That means that sometime in your spiritual walk, listen to me, every person in this place, there is going to be confrontation. So, Pastor Brian's on the back there. He's sleeping because he's sick and taking medicine. That's okay. I'm going to give him a pass tonight. Pastor Brian came to us, and he is a pacifist. He was a pacifist. And within the first year being here, I said, we've got a problem. Because you know how to get up and speak, which is a wonderful thing, but you don't know how to pastor. Because in order to pastor people, you're going to have confrontation. And this is what you always say, Pastor, I don't like confrontation. I don't like confrontation. It's not in my nature. And I said, you know what? You can never pastor people if you can't learn to confront them. Because what we're saying is, your deceived way is okay. Right. It's okay for you to be deceived. It's okay to walk down that road of deception that might lead you to hell. Come on now. And listen to me. It's not okay. And so there is going to be inherently a confrontation. Well, here's the thing. In a growing church, I can't always be the person that confronts everybody. So what we had to do, and our plan has been all along, is to bring in more pastors. Now, let me talk about that for just a moment so everybody gets this picture, because I'm going someplace with this tonight. Because I'm letting you know the why of why we do some things. Why did we bring in more pastors? Because there needs to be some personal interaction between a pastor and a person. So there can be oftentimes that personal relationship and confrontation. I say it often, church is more than an event, and if you think you're going to get everything you need from a preacher getting up and standing on Sunday morning, I will tell you, you can come to church faithfully for years and never grow spiritually. Because it's easy to hide all your stuff in the darkness and just come and live the way you want to. And a lot of people, and that, you understand, that's the American church today. By and large, listen to me, and I'm typifying the American church, a bunch of immature babies. Still sucking on the bottle. Because they've never come to the place to understand that for me to grow, there's going to be somebody, sometime, somewhere, that loves me and is going to speak truth to my life, and they're going to come, and there's going to be a confrontation. And so what we do is, well, I don't like that, I'll just go down the street. And so we develop these people who go from one church to the next church to the next church. Not a funny story. Shelley and I were at a funeral of a man that had passed away that went to this church. True story. The pastor got up and he said, I'm amazed. I asked Sister so-and-so. Because just how many pastors and people, he said, how many churches have y'all gone to over the years? The number was incredible. Can I tell you something? I pastored those people. So I can speak honestly about this, is that they didn't want to take correction from anybody. Especially as a young 30-year-old pastor here in this church. I was stupid and didn't know what I was doing. And they certainly weren't going to take correction from me. But it wasn't just me. They would go to other places. Now, I say that because this. How many of you believe that God has a plan for your life? Can I see your hands? Now, I'm going to ask a more personal question. How many of you believe that God makes mistakes? I don't believe that either. How many of you believe that God sends you to a church? Let me see your hands. You believe that God sends you to a church? Okay. Some of you are getting real scared, like we're going to have this personal intervention tonight. There's no intervention going on tonight. I mean, you're just everybody's getting nervous, like, oh man, he's really about to drop the hammer on me. I'm not going to drop the hammer on anybody tonight. If that being true, here's the thing. I believe that being said, everybody here wants to grow spiritually. But here's the thing, we've got to come to a conclusion. Oftentimes, we don't know what that looks like or how to get there. Because God does use test, trial, and tribulation oftentimes to spur the things that are necessary in our life to bring us to a place where we get ready for that next spiritual growth process. And he uses people in our life oftentimes that can reveal things that weren't God in our life that keeps causing that process to keep taking place in our life. Like some of you sit here and you say, I've gone around this mountain 100 times. Can I tell you something tonight? You don't have to go around this mountain 100 times. But you know what? You're going to have to be willing to change your thinking and listen to some truth. Yeah. And so we've come to a world where the church is about entertainment. It's about an educational resource. It's about a guilt reliever. Or it's something that's just traditional. But the church has to be, and here's two things, it has to be organic and relational to see maturity. So here's what our plan, I've just said it, that we have made a plan, even in this last year, that we brought on more pastors. And my goal in bringing on more pastors is not for them to relieve what I have to do, but for them to enable to grow people spiritually. That's the goal. But with that being said, what happens with that is this. Now, understand something. All of us here, we're all Americans. Okay? There's only one culture in America that's moving away from American culture. All the rest of the ethnic groups are all moving in a group towards this American culture. That's what the left can't understand and everything, and they're all their ideology. Can I ask a question? Let's get this, because here's the thing. I love, and I'm going to tell you something. I love all cultures. I love African-American culture. I love Hispanic culture. How many second-generation Hispanics do we have here? Your parents came from Mexico, and you're a second-generation Hispanic. Can I see your hands? All right. Love you guys. Here's the crazy thing about second-generation Hispanics that you all know. Many second-generation Hispanics don't even speak Spanish. There's one sitting here on the front row that's agreeing with me because she doesn't speak Spanish at all. And we can give our opinion on that, and many Hispanics do. What a shame, da-da-da-da-da-da, okay. We get it, and they feel less out of both groups now. Because they feel like they don't fit in either group now, because you have one group bringing condemnation to them because they don't embrace culture. But there's one thing, we're the church. And you know what? I'm not here to condemn anybody about that. I'm not here to pass judgment or give an opinion one way or another about that. I'm just glad these people are here. But we begin talking about this and how culturally we begin to meld together and move in a direction, and we're talking about providing people to come to a place of spiritual maturity. There are a lot of things that hinder that in the process of our thinking. So the American way is this. We love things. Somebody say amen. I'm going someplace with this, so just stay with me. I know you say, where in the world are you going? Loving things, I could say today, and I'd love to say, well, folks, we've got a new plan. We've got 10 acres of property here, and we're going to endeavor to build this new $14 million facility. And I could get up and talk about it, and being the salesperson that I am, because you understand something, everyone is a salesperson. You sell the restaurants you like, you sell the movies you like, you sell your opinion and your ideas to everybody that will listen to you. I could get up and I could show you the blueprints and I could show you the pictures, and everybody here would get excited. Come on now. And some of you would even begin to make sacrifices in your income to help us accomplish this great goal. But can I tell you something? It's just a building. Heaven and earth, this earth is going to pass away. Come on now. But when we begin talking about pastors taking care of people, there's nothing sexy about that vision. How many of you understand what I'm talking about? You know, there's not this tangible, wow, look at that. Isn't that great? Look at my church. You know, we want to build a church bigger than that church down there, and we want the edifices to be taller, and we want everybody to say, wow, look at that. When you say, well, my church has a vision of taking care of the people and providing more pastors, people go, oh. Okay. Let me just tell you something so you get the picture. I'm not here as a fundraiser tonight. We need more space right now. We have plans to educate and to mature people. And because of the pastors we've hired, we have every pastor has an office. Yeah. But what that means is every office that's taken is one less classroom that we have here at this church. And so it is a great sacrifice, and they're not willing to share their office as a classroom. I haven't convinced them of that yet. Pastor Glenn will share his. If you can fit in between his counseling schedule, then you can go and do what you want in there. So let's talk about something so everybody understands what I'm talking about tonight. We have lived in very precarious, fearful times. Not just this church, but churches, and one of the greatest churches in this nation, where the pastor is a good friend of mine. Starting back before September, in this church and churches across this nation, giving began to decline. Because people were scared about what was going to happen in this country. And being fearful, they began to hold on to their money. So they held on to their money. But can I tell you something? Hear what I'm about to say. Fear is never faith. Because let me tell you something about fear. Once it grabs hold of, it doesn't want to let go. You know, it's the crazy part of something that I want everybody here to understand. You cannot control your sin. You might believe it's in control, but nor like doctors can't control cancer is metastasized. You cannot control sin, and you can't control fear, because you thought it was just about money, and the next thing you know, it's about everything else in your life. And so our thoughts as pastors, him and I, was, well, when this election is over, things will settle down and people will get back to normal and giving. And can I tell you something? It has not happened. It hasn't happened in that church, and they're making some budget adjustments, big-time budget adjustments, and it hasn't happened here. And I realize one of the things that is important to me, I think that it's important as a good leader and a visionary leader that you get up and you give the why of why you do things. Because if you don't tell people the why, they can never buy into why you do things. And so I've said so in passing and all these things, and what I'm telling you tonight is this. And let me just burst a misconception, because we have a lot of young, great Christians here. There are a lot of young Christians that believe, when I get spiritually mature, I'll tithe. Can I tell you something? You will never be spiritually mature until you start to tithe.
That's right. Amen. That's right.
You know, there are a lot of people who believe that. They believe, when I get spiritually mature, I will tithe. But I'm going to tell you something. You will never become spiritually mature until you do tithe. Because it is a step of faith that takes you out of fear. And you understand something. Here's what Pastor's saying tonight. Stay with me. I am not talking about money. I'm being confrontational about your fear. I'm looking you in the eye and I'm saying, this is what this is. It is fear. I am not talking about tradition. I believe it to be absolutely biblical. I believe, as I said on Sunday, you may not believe it to be a salvation issue, but I will tell you without a doubt, it is a judgment day issue, and you will stand before God and you will give an account and you will say, I spent all that money on me, and you're going to see how that washes. My wife says this all the time about all kinds of different things. She lives in the fear of the Lord. I'm going to tell you straight up. And she'll say something, and this is what she says all the time. I'd be afraid to do that. I'd be afraid because she believes that when you give your heart and life to Jesus, that it's no longer your money. In fact, God says this in Malachi. It's Word of God. You can say it's Old Testament, but you understand something. It's still the Word of God. God says, you're robbing from me. When you keep your tithe, he said, you are robbing from me. And now we are bought with a price. And we say it and we sing it, and we, amazing grace, we never could have paid for it, we never could have bought it, we never could have worked our way through it. We were bought with a high price, and this, then we say, but hold on, all this stuff is mine. Now, I'm changing your thinking tonight, because I want you to understand there's a confrontation happening here, and some of you don't like it. But it's necessary and needed. The confrontation here is this. I'm going to tell you, you're wrong. It's not up to your opinion. It's not up to your idealism. It's not up to say, well, I believe every person is entitled to their own opinion. That's American way of thinking, and that's not kingdom thinking. You say, well, Pastor, it doesn't matter. I'm going to go to heaven, and it's all going to be okay. And I'm telling you tonight, you're going to have to stand before God, and it may not be okay. And the things that we flirt with is saying they're not salvation issues. What if they are? Because you can't control the steps where you walk in disobedience. Amen. Pastor Glenn was sharing with me, and some of you have seen the movie, so we're going to venture and go someplace so y'all can have a moment of leisure here for a moment. It's the opening scene of a very popular movie they show on TV all the time, Miss Congeniality. Sandra Bullock is there, and she's working undercover, and she gets the order as the guy is choking on the peanut or whatever it is, do not get up. And she gets up, and he pulls a knife, and another officer gets shot. And her superiors say to her, you have a problem. You cannot follow direction. And she says, I mostly follow direction. Now listen to me and hear what I'm about to say. I don't believe where there's a king and he has absolute authority and truth that that's going to wash. Well, I mostly follow direction. You say, Pastor, where is the grace in that? There's a lot of grace in that. There's a lot of grace because you know where the grace is? He gives us opportunity after opportunity after opportunity after opportunity after opportunity after opportunity. And we have mistaken grace when people tell us what we want to hear instead of what we need to hear. We have become, as it says in 2 Timothy, we have itching ears and we just want somebody to scratch and tell us what we want to hear. And I realize we're not talking about a money issue here. Because I believe that people in our church don't understand. See, what you don't understand is this, is that collectively we are the body of Christ. Yes. Paul talks about it all the time. And you may say, well, I don't make a lot, so my little bit doesn't count. But can I tell you something? Every person that doesn't do what they're supposed to do affects something. And so where we're at, and me being the senior pastor here that has to oversee and do things, where we're at and the decisions we have to make because of the lingering things that are happening, I have to take a hard, long look at personnel when it comes first of the year. And everybody's going to say, well, that's just not fair. I agree with you. It's just not fair. Because, can I tell you something? Everybody's obedience is important. From the little, from the young person who has their first job, it's important. You say, Pastor, you have a conviction about giving. You better believe I do. And I live that, Shelly and I, we live that conviction. We live it year after year after year after year because you understand something? It's not about how much we make. It's about how much we can give. That's what we believe. And so the Apostle Paul says, here's what we need. We need to plead, encourage, and urge. And he says we need to do all these things to live lives worthy. I want you to grow spiritually. Somebody say amen. Amen. I want you to grow spiritually, but for that to happen, I'm going to have to plead, encourage, and urge. I'm going to have to come to you with the truth and say, okay, this is what the truth is. The truth is, here's an area in your life that's holding you back. That I talk about it all the time. We live in a postmodern world, and here's what postmodern thinking is, and it is inundated and educated from the time our kids go to kindergarten that they begin to say, okay, you can think and believe and act any way you want to because that's who you are. Can I tell you something? The gender issue has nothing to do with the gender issue. It's the ultimate fruit of postmodern thinking, which says, I have the ability to think and believe whoever I am. It doesn't matter who I hurt or what anybody else thinks. This is who I am. You say, well, we have a lot of young people who are very confused. Why are they very confused? Because they have bought into this lie to say, you know what? Whatever you believe is truth is truth. And that's not what this is. See, your kids are going to come home from school like my kids do. And they're not just being fed math sometimes. They're being fed all of this other crap. And I have to come back and say, hold on just a second. The Word of God says we're being made in His image and likeness, not your image and likeness. Since when did that change? Just because you have a tattoo of Jesus doesn't mean you're like Him. You say, boy, you're on a roll tonight. Hey, guys, on live stream, how are y'all doing tonight? You've already turned me off. That's okay. These people are being very considerate tonight and kind. And what we have to come back to is understanding. Here's the agreement that Pastor Gary Brothers and I have with each other, and this is what scares me to death. And I've told you this, it scares me to death. If we don't have a move of God in this generation, in the window that we have, the church will no longer be the church in the next 10 years. There will be a handful of people that is the church, and maybe that's what God is doing, refining. It's His business, not mine. The majority of the people who tithe and give in this church are over the age of 40. By and large, the greater majority is over the age of 50. The younger generation believes that they can give as will. If I have it, great. If I don't have it, well, God understands. That requires no faith. Because you're saying that the tithe belongs to you, but the Word of God tells me the tithe belongs to the Lord. It doesn't say the tithe belongs to me. So what we believe in this church is you can't take your tithe in this church and say, well, I want to give it to the music department. No, you can't, because the tithe doesn't belong to you. You can't designate your tithe. That's an offering. The tithe belongs to the Lord. And so you give, and you give in faith. Now, I'm going to ask a question because I'm going to tell you I love these people. How many here come from the Catholic tradition? Can I see your hands, please? God bless you, folks. I love Catholics that come into the church because they have greater faith than anybody else, because for years they give to something they have no idea where the money goes. Come on now. I'm just telling you the truth. And then they come into church like us, and we say, okay, this is where the money goes. Like, wow, I didn't need to know that. That's okay. I'm going to give anyway. I mean, you understand people not Catholics all the time, but I'm going to tell you something. They have to have great faith to do what they do. Sometimes they go to Mass, and they don't understand anything anybody says. I'm telling you the truth. I mean, you can go to a Spanish Mass, and they're speaking Latin, and everybody just sitting there, you know, and they don't know what anybody's saying. They're just saying, hey, it's God. And then we have problems with speaking in tongues. Just saying. So I love when Catholics come and say, oh man, we want to, God's given and we're going to, I say, come on in. So if you're Catholic watching tonight, there's a place for you here at Life Mini Church. There's a responsibility that we have that as a pastor, Pastor Glenn was sharing with me Monday, Pastor, this is where we're at financially. It's one of his responsibilities. I'm driving to Oklahoma to get my daughter. And I've told you many times, there are a couple things that happen to a pastor. When you give and you preach like I do on Sunday, when I come on Monday, I am whipped and wore out. And so he's talking to me, and I'm hanging up the phone, and I am just ticked off. And my lovely wife, I love her, and she is full of so faith. And so she starts preaching back to me my sermons. Didn't you say? Oh, my goodness. I've had to apologize for that numerous times because I was ticked off. The Bible says, be angry and sin not. I failed. So I began to pray. And I realized, you know something? We're on the right track. We're on the right track. We have great pastors here at Life Mini Church. They want to encourage, rebuke. They want to bring strength to you. They love you. They care for you. So excited. Some of you may not know, Pastor Nick and Pastor Carol are going to begin to head up our life groups, and we're going to put more investment into our mentors in this next year. We have plans to do that. We're going to invest in our mentors because we want you to be the best mentors that you also can do what God has called you to do. And so I'm excited about them doing that. Pastor Brian, he's moving up and taking on additional responsibility in our young adults. He's trained up young men and young ladies to be over other ministries in our junior high department. Jonathan comes from a pastor's home and he plays drums here, and you might just see him play drums, but that little guy, he is a preacher. I mean, he is a pastor. And so he's gotten in there, and they got a team over there, and so on junior high. So Pastor Brian, that's happening next door, and Pastor Brian's sitting in here tonight. Amen. You know what that means? He's done a good job. So he's doing the same thing in the high school ministry. He's raising up leaders, and now he's taking on the young adults. And you understand something as you begin to raise and duplicate and raise and disciple and duplicate. But this is what he'll tell you. After about 2 years of being here, this is what he said. He said, I didn't know that it meant confrontation every day. He said, does it ever get easier? I said, no. Because people are growing and you got to say, okay, here's the deal. And sometimes you have to look somebody in the eye and say, tell me why again you're doing that. And all it takes is somebody for them to say it out loud for them to realize, oh, that's really stupid. Sometimes that's the simplest counseling as it happens. It happens in 5 seconds in my office. And I sit them down and I say, tell me why again you're doing that. That is so childish. And you know, when you can get the revelation without somebody else telling you, right, it takes. That's as simple as the confrontation is sometimes. It's not getting your grill and shake you and waterboard you and all that kind of stuff, you know? We're against waterboarding at church. That's my stand. I'm just letting you know. But we're not against making you feel uncomfortable as you sit there. That you go home and you say, I didn't like that. That made me so uncomfortable because this is what I believe. And so I'm going to ask you a question. Why do you believe that? Well, I've gone to church all my life. No, that's not what I'm asking. Why do you believe that? Well, there's this and that. Don't talk to me about pick and choose what you want to pick and choose out of this book. Here's the crazy part about this. We're not saved by works, but we'll be judged by them. We're not saved by our works, but the Word of God says you're going to be judged by them. How many of you believe that those works include giving? Jesus took time to watch the offering being given when he could have been out raising people from the dead. He only had 3 years. I would say it's pretty important to him. He talked more about money than he did raising the dead. I would say it's pretty important to him. You know why? Because it's the one hang-up we have with faith. It gets us, especially as Americans, it gets us. I'm not asking you to sacrifice everything you have. I'm not asking that tonight. What I am asking is that you be obedient to what God's calling you to do. Quit making excuses. Quit saying, I can't afford to do that. Can I tell you something? You can't afford not to do this. Because here's the crazy part, and I'm wrapping up. Pastor Glenn and Judy are here tonight. Shelley and I live the same way. I believe in keeping good books, but our books never work out. I'm not certain how it always works. Because what comes in doesn't match what goes out. You say, how does that happen? When you dedicate this money to God, he makes up the difference. He does. I mean, sometimes we get miracle of miracles at our house. We get a check from an insurance company for no good reason. That is like pulling money out of a fish's mouth. You don't get money from an insurance company for no good reason. I work for an insurance company. They just don't do that. And that's happened numerous times. We made a mistake. I didn't change anything. How is that possible? It's God. And so I believe with all my heart that God has called this church to do something. And I'm asking for those who watching tonight, you weren't able to be here, and those here, I just want you to pray and ask God to help you be obedient. Because I'm telling you, every part makes a difference. Every part makes a difference. Will you bow your heads with me? Father, we come tonight. And Lord, it's not about being crass or cruel. That's not my intention at all tonight. My intention is, Lord, that we may begin to ask those hard questions of ourselves about how we've perceived ourselves to be so right. And maybe we've been so wrong. Lord, I seed not for just myself. I seed for my kids. I seed for a next generation. Lord, even when it hurts and it's painful, because you're always faithful. And you're teaching me to be faithful. So I pray today over a spirit of fear that has gripped people's hearts and minds and lives. And I come against that spirit of fear today. Lord, that you can be trusted. I'm going to ask something tonight, and I'm not asking for immediate response, and I'm not asking for you to give anything tonight, but here's what I'm going to ask. Tonight, a seed has been planted in your mind that has provoked something that has become normal in your life, that you know there's some things in your life, it may not even pertain to money, that need to change in your thinking. I want to pray over you right now. So if you'll raise your hand, I want to pray that that seed's going to grow inside of you. Just raise your hand right now. Praise God. Praise God. Father, I pray over every uplifted hand that your spirit is the spirit of truth. He's not the spirit of confusion, because when we're confused, it's not him. He is a spirit of resolute, absolute purity and truth. And tonight we accept that absolute purity and truth. And we accept what he's speaking to us. And so, Lord, I ask that we no longer walk in deception, but our eyes be open tonight. Lord, as Paul prayed over those believers, he said, may the eyes of your understanding be enlightened. May your understanding come clear to you what the truth really is. Lord, I pray that over each and every person and those watching tonight, Lord, that they might know and they might believe. And I thank you for these things in Jesus' name. Amen.